Now we'll see the question that is, the discoloration of the tooth in tetracycline therapy is because of formation of what? If you see, it may be due to the formation of the calcium orthophosphate or the dicalcium phosphate dihydrate or the calcium oxide or the tetracalcium phosphate. So the tetracycline will cause the discoloration during the formation period, as we know. Okay, so why it will form discoloration? Because there is the calcium which is present in the tooth will form the calcium orthophosphate complex when it interacts with the tetracyclines. So that's how this calcium orthophosphate is formed because of the tetracycline therapy. And this forms if the tetracycline dose is about 21 mg per kg body weight. Greater than this, it will produce the discoloration. Next question we'll see is that the replacement resorption is characterized by, okay, the pain. It will not have pain. Apical pathosis, yeah, it may lead to the apical pathosis, but it's not the characteristic feature. Acute inflammation, no, it is also the not characteristic feature. If you read about the replacement resorption, you'll be easily answering this. That is a tooth ankylosis. Because the replacement resorption is a resorption of the root surface and it is substitution by the bone resulting in the ankylosis. So the replacement resorption accompanies this dentoalveolar ankylosis due to the extensive trauma to the tooth attachment apparatus, that is a PDL ligament. In worst cases, we can most likely to see the replacement resorptions. Okay, next question is that a base is a base that is typically placed over the calcium hydroxide base that has been placed over a pulp exposure. So the answer here we got here, the primary base is like calcium hydroxide. Fine. The secondary base is obviously the top layer base over the calcium hydroxide will form the secondary base. This is a direct question. Okay. The primary base usually placed in contact with that of pulpal exposure or the close proximity with that of pulpal exposure so that it will provide some protection from the toxic and the thermal irritants. So over top of it, whenever the other base is placed, it is a secondary base. Okay. Next question we'll see is that the prognosis of the broken instrument in the root canal is good when the instrument is less than 20 number, either it is a 20 number or 25 or 35, it is not related to the number, but it is the file which is broken in the root canal. This prognosis is not related to this, so it is eliminated. And the instrument lodged in the bone beyond the apical area. If it is touching the bone, it will have a severe pain at or after the procedure. So this is also eliminated. It will not give any good prognosis. Instrument obliteration at the apical third of the canal. Okay, if the instrument is literally obliterating the apical third of the canal, then what we can do is that we can remove this instrument using an apicectomy procedure, and we can radicularly close this area by removing the axillary canals here and completely sealing this area. That's how we can increase the prognosis of the root canal treated tooth even if it is over instrumented. And if the instrument is in the middle, then what happens is that we can do the bypass, but the thing is it will not give the good prognosis has this has compared to the apical third obliteration because foreign instrument is still present in the canal. Okay. Next question we'll see is that the stabilization of the avulsed tooth requires at till what time? That is 1 or 2 weeks, 2 or 3 weeks, 4 to 6 weeks, or the more than 6 weeks. See, it has to be as less as minimal because if it is placed for more duration, that is greater than 2 weeks, it may lead to the replacement resorption and subsequent ankylosis. Okay. So that's the reason the stabilization should be only 1 or 2 weeks. The best prognosis is for the apical third fracture fracture in the middle third or the coronal third fracture. See, we should know the treatment options for this to answer the question. So the fracture in the apical third, what we can do, we can just leave the segment there itself and do the remaining root canal therapy to the remaining tooth structure. And the fracture in the middle third, we can go for the intraradicular splinting, but it is not as good prognosis when compared to the coronal third. Because what we can do in the coronal third fracture is that the treatment option would be here is that immediate repositioning of the coronal segment and stabilization using the splinting procedure. That's how we can give the good prognosis when compared to the apical as well as the middle third. Okay. The source of the calcium hydroxide in the dentin bridges, that is the blood, saliva, calcium hydroxide or the intracellular fluid. See, the calcium hydroxide, when it is placed on the pulp tissue, what happens is that it will neutralize the lactic acids of the osteoclast. And as it is antibacterial, it will encourage the repair and stimulates the alkaline phosphate, which induces the calcification. That's how the dentin bridge is formed with the help of the calcium hydroxide by being the source from the blood of the pulp tissue. Okay, it will take the nutrients from it and helps in dentin bridge formation. Next, we'll see the what a stunned pulp is. See, if you see the options, you may get confused between the option A and B, but the answer is that immediately after the trauma, what happens is that the vitality test is still negative. That has a pulp is stunned because it got shocked. Okay, some trauma, it got shocked. That's the reason it is stunned. So the nerve bundles, which are temporarily paralyzed here, if you see the nerve bundles are paralyzed here, will not respond to the electric pulp test also. So with the help of the electric pulp test, we can see the pulp is stunned. Okay, but not the stunning appearance on the radiograph. We cannot see anything in the radiograph. It's just radiolucent. So this option is obviously eliminated. And the necrosed pulp is not stunned. Now the hyperemic is also hyperemic. It will never be stunned. Next is that the pain due to the thermal change after the trauma will occur during the periapical inflammation, periapical necrosis, pedial injury, and the root fracture. See, the pain by the thermal change signifies the pulpal inflammation. There is a pulpal inflammation. So, any thermal change with respect to the fractured tooth will alter the blood supply here. Okay. And it will increase the extravascular fluid, which leads to the increase in the intrapulpal pressure. So that's the reason the root fracture will experience the thermal pain during the thermal changes. Okay. Next question we'll see is that the ideal method for restoring a fractured tooth is open face stainless steel crown. Obviously not the stainless steel crowns in the anterior region is a bad option because of the aesthetics. And the reattachment of the crown fragment. Yeah, this is one of the best option among the strip crowns and the composite resin restorations also. Because it will give us the natural shape, contour, surface texture, and the occlusal alignment and the color of the fragment, which offer the excellent aesthetics and the functional results with the less chair set time. Next question we'll see is that which is a hybrid instrument among these options? That is a H-files, not the H-files. These are direct instruments. It is not an hybrid instrument. Unifile is used in the case of the calcified canals. So no, because of its configuration, even it is not the hybrid instrument. And the U-file is also helpful for removal of the instrument separated. So it is also not an appropriate answer. So the other option left is a flexofile. See, in the file name itself, it's like a combination of the two. That is the best stainless steel technology with an enhanced flexibility. That's helpful for the cleaning and shaping, even in the most curved and the narrowest canals. And it has the safe ended tip, which will reduces the chance of the ledging. Okay. Next question is that the mix pattern compactor is of what shape? It is in the shape of reverse blade of the key file or the reverse blade of the H file in the sonic instrument or the none of the above. Among this, the reverse blade of the H file would be an appropriate answer if you know the configuration of the mix pad and compactor, because it is used in vertical as well as the lateral condensation. And this helps, this method helps in use to heat to decrease the gutta percha viscosity and increases its plasticity. Okay, because the gutta percha points will get attached to the surface of this reverse blade of the H file. Okay, then it is placed in the canal and heat is produced among this. RC prep is a combination of, it is a combination of EDTA with the carbamide peroxide or the hydrogen peroxide or the sodium hypochlorite or the urea peroxide. So the combination of EDTA and urea peroxide was developed by the Stewart, and it is very effective in lubricating the cleaning agent for the root canals. And they are helpful for the deeper penetration of the medicament into the dentin. So if you read the composition of the RC prep, it is a combination of the EDTA with the urea peroxide. Next question is, the most of the failures of the replanted tooth are due to the replacement resorption. See, they asked not only the avulsated but also the replanted tooth. Replanted tooth can also be the autotransplantation. So we cannot directly go for the replacement resorption, which is most common for the avulsion. So the answer among this is the external resorption, because here after replantation, the resorption is initiated in the periodontium, initially affecting the external surface of the tooth and also lead to the fracture of the replanted tooth. Okay, so the most failures of the replanted are due to the external resorption from the predial injury. Next question is, this Stiglitz pliers are used for holding the silver points. Yes, if you read properly, the Stiglitz plier helpful for holding the silver points in the olden days. But now, in the recent years, we use the Stiglitz pliers for removal of the broken instrument tips. So the answer would be A and C, because they just can be placed into the canal by just grasping the broken instrument. It can be easily retrieved. So it is especially used for this purpose in recent years. Next question is that, which of the following lasers is said ideal for the hard tissue cutting and drilling? That is the erbium, YAG, neon, YSGG, or the argon. Among this, the YSGG and the carbon dioxide lasers are the soft and hard tissue lasers. That's the reason among these options, the YSGG is appropriate for hard tissue cutting and the drilling. Okay, next question we'll see is the material of choice for the endodontic post. So the plastic, it is brittle. It is not always preferred. Metal, they are hard and they cannot be manipulated according to the root shape. So they're also not the material of choice. And the fiber reinforced, yeah. In recent years, the fiber reinforced is more preferred because of its lot of advantages. That is, it has a high fatigue resistance, low elastic modulus, which is similar to that of dentin, and the excellent light conductivity, which are attributed to the fiber reinforced post. Next question is that, the identify the instrument. See, this looks like a three-way syringe at one point and a irrigator attached to it. So it will become the strip co-irrigator, because it is an instrument used for the irrigating precisely under the surgical operating microscopes. This is the one of the instrument which helps in irrigating in a controlled manner during the operating microscope procedures. Next question we'll see is that, the pulp stem cells are the pluripotent, totipotent, multipotent, or the none of them. The pulp stem cells are always pluripotent in nature because they undergo the proliferation and they migrate to the site of injured odontoblast, and that's how they produce the dentin here. So the pulp stones, the pulp stem cells are always pluripotent stem cells. Okay. Next question is that, In cementing restoration, the cement displacement is by the excess pressure, the hydraulic pressure, or the presence of the excess cement or the thin mix of the cement. Here, the cement displacement is a key factor for successfully cementing the restorations. So, the process is a hydraulic, that is liquid in a motion one, dependent on the rapid flow and the escape of the excess cement. So, we cannot directly go for the excess pressure or the presence of excess cement. Because of its hydraulic pressure, it will remove the excess cement. Next question is that disadvantage of the ceramic veneers. This is one of the direct question we can say. That is a discoloration, low strength, or the absorption of the oral fluid, or the tactic sensitive. If you see, it will not cause discoloration. It will not have the low strength. It will have the high strength. And it is not absorbed by the oral fluid. So these three options are easily eliminated. So because of its brittle nature, it is very technique sensitive. Next question is that the fluoride released from the GIC restoration is replaced by, that is the hydroxyl ions, aluminium ions, silicate ions, or the carboxylate ions. So the free fluoride in the cement is incorporated in the hydroxyl apatite crystals just by removing the hydroxyl ions, and that's how the fluorapatite crystals are formed. So here, if you know the mechanism of the GIC, the fluoride is released, but it will not participate in the cross-linking of the cement. So that's the reason the hydroxyl ion will replace the fluoride in the GIC restoration. Next is the dentin bonding agents usually contain what? See, dentin is hydrophilic in nature. Okay, agreed. And the composite is hydrophobic. So we need such an agent which contains both hydrophilic, which can attach to the dentin, and also the hydrophobic, which can be attached to the composite or the other component. That's the reason the option should be the hydrophobic as well as the hydrophilic component. Okay. Next question we'll see is that shade determines